So what we're doing is we're building an app where you can kind of scroll through a bunch of NBA players. I'm also adding a very basic interaction, which I'll show after a little bit here. But these are, you know, these are their names, and we have their bio photo here. As you can see, I am totally an awesome designer. This is like the best that design could be here. There may be other people coming on your show that are doing some really cool stuff with design. I am not going to be one of those people. I'm definitely more on the data side. What I have is a URL to, it's just a JSON file, but we're pretending like this is some sort of an API, right? In fact, I'll go ahead and load that up here just so people can see there's a lot of data coming in. And, you know, and but the main thing that we're going to look at here is that there is a list of players that are coming in, and they happen to have a name and they happen to have an image. Okay. So those are the two things we care about. All right. So at the heart of a React app is a function, generally speaking. You can do it with classes as well, but most people do it with functions these days. The in this case, we are, by the way, we're on Code Sandbox. And you can see that we have an app here and we are exporting it, and then it'll render in this right-hand panel. I'll come back to the use effect in a second. What you do return is something that looks a lot like HTML. This is called JSX. And this gets kind of transformed as we as it's bundled into actual JavaScript functions. So, you know, these will turn into something else in the background. But for the most part, you can pretty much think of them as HTML. There are very few changes, mainly class name instead of class, for example. H1 at the top with NBA players, and then we're doing an unordered list and list items, and we're mapping through all the players, which I'll show you how we got those in a second. And we are rendering a link and an image and the name. And so the link is right there, and we have an on click to do something. And stop me anytime you need me to explain something, Christopher. Happy to do so.
Yeah, no. So far, all of this looks good. I just like the fact that you've got Pablo Torre's favorite Ben Simmons on the list there.
Perfect. Ben Simmons is an awesome player. Would love to have him for my Blazers. So we have a fetch rosters asynchronous function in. Of course, this is JavaScript. We often do TypeScript, but for the purposes of this demo, I'm keeping things simple. And we're awaiting a fetch. We grab this data right here, and then we do this .json call, which will turn it into a JSON object. So useEffect is a hook. This comes from React. useEffect is essentially something that, especially when you give it this, I'm not going to go too deeply into this, but basically, when you give it this second argument of just like an empty array here, it will run only when the component is first mounted, basically. And so this allows you to do things like kick off an asynchronous request, which is exactly what we're doing, or make other changes that are side effects, essentially, is what it's called in the React world. So I'm calling this function that I created, fetch rosters, and I'm providing a dot then, so that the rosters, when they come back as JSON, will come back as data here. And then I'm mapping through that. Remember that players property that we mm-hmm. had in the JSON? I'm mapping through and grabbing just the two pieces of data that we care about, the name and the image URL. Grabbing the player name, image URL, both of those are strings. And then lastly, I am running this function, which you can get when you destructure this use state. Again, another hook from React. This is one particular piece of state. It's all of the players that we are displaying on the right. When you first start, it's just empty. So if I were to, for example, hit refresh here, you'll for a second see nothing, and then it loads in, right? So when you see nothing, that means that it's just this. And I could put like a loading state and stuff if I saw that, hey, players.length is zero. Set players, when you call set players, it will re-render this and provide a new set of players in the next time that you run it. Players then get mapped in as list items. So each player is mapped to that. We're providing a key so it knows, you know, that this is Kevin Love's row here. And if he gets sorted down below, it'll kind of reuse that and make it faster. And then we're just doing this this link here with an image, with a name. So those single letter variables that you love so much, Christopher, just for your sake, I will change those. this should really say player. Okay.
I for anybody who doesn't know, I have a huge peeve when it comes to single letter variables. It just drives me crazy.
I tend to use them if it's just like a one-liner, but I agree with you when it starts getting longer like this. Like when you're way down in the weeds here, what does P mean anymore?
Yeah, exactly.
So we know that it's player name here. Yeah, yep. So much better. Cool. And then I also provided a function. So you mentioned earlier, Christopher, that when you want to make a change, you kind of you replace the state and then it will re-render. And that is true. So in this case, on click, whenever you click on something over here, we are changing the player name. And what we have to do is, this is a little bit technical for React, but just stick with me for a second. We have existing players that have been loaded in. What you do is you provide a callback function and it will tell you, okay, these are the current players that have been loaded in at this point. So we've clicked that player. We know what player it is. This is just a string with their name. And it's actually the whole player. So it has the name and the image URL. And what we do is we map through all of them. If the name is the one we clicked on, like Kyle Alexander here, and I click, it changes the name to Jamon Holmgren and of course kills the image URL because I don't have one. Not in the NBA, unfortunately.
Not yet. So not yet.
Not yet. Maybe at age 40 tomorrow, you know, next year I'll make it. Otherwise, if it's not that name, then we just return the one that was already there because we don't want to change it. Like these should all stay the same.
Right.
So you notice that once we ran that set players and returned the new map, it re-rendered this and the change came in and I'm slowly taking over the NBA. Now I did notice a bug here that I didn't have time to mess with. I don't understand why it dropped in three right there.
That's
immaterial. Yeah. We're going to be replacing all of this anyway.
So the big thing that I'm noticing and I'm really curious if MST can resolve this, because this is a problem that I've had in the bit of work that I've done with React is, you know, you've got a list of items that you've now displayed out and that's over here in some component. Somebody has clicked on it or they've done something to one individual item. And now what I need to do is I need to act upon that one individual item back here, inside my parent app, I'm storing that list. And so now what I need to do is I now need to go find that silly thing or figure out some way that I can pass that over and then I can go ahead and update that. So I will typically use like a filter or a find to go find it. You've used a map there, which I mean, you know, it's very much a potato kind of approach there. And it's something that honestly always just leaves me feeling hollow. Like this just doesn't feel like a good way to write code. It works, but it just feels super inefficient.
It does feel inefficient. And in this case, actually, if you were to simply find the player with the name and change it in place, because React, like I said, is a little bit naive and you simply return the original array, it would look and say, well, it's the same array, so nothing's changed. And that can be a problem because then it won't re-render. And so in this case, I'm actually using a map because I want it to see a new array. But you're right, it's very wasteful. We're creating a whole new array with all of the things that are the same, and we have only really changed one element.
Yeah, I'll use a spread operator to then get around that.
Yes.
The three little dots.
A great way to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah. So there are a few different... So this is a great way to do it, but one of the problems that kind of comes up is what if you need these players in another component? You know, a different component. Now, in this case, we're in the root app, but let's say that we were in some other app or some other component, we would have to bring that state up higher in the app architecture into like a parent component that was a common parent between these two leaf nodes, and then pass it all the way down to the components that need it. So now you've got like, we're fetching players in some sort of like a screen component or something like a page, you know, wrapper, which is not exactly relevant to the wrapper. The wrapper doesn't care about it, but it just happens to be the common root point for two different components that happen to need this bit of data. Right. Another issue that comes up is that your state is kind of spread throughout your app. Like you've got all these little use states everywhere and they're not all in one place. So if someone were to say, just give me a big dump of all of your state, maybe to save it, for example, or to debug in some way, it's not all in one place. It's actually just spread among many components.
Because every time that you go, hey, I need this as part of my state, I need this as part of my state, you're now calling that use state. And then you're also creating like a brand new variable for that piece of state and a brand new function then to go in and update that later on. That also, again, just like sounds inefficient and just leaves me with that hollow feeling. It's like I've got, you know, even just like 10 pieces of state. Now I've got 10 functions for me to use to update all of that. Like I can't keep track of all of that in my head.
Yeah, yeah. It can definitely be weird. And I mean, some people built very involved apps using just these tools, as well as another one, which is context. Now, context allows you to, instead of like passing the state all the way down into sub components, which, you know, is it's a viable way to go. You can use context, which kind of puts it into sort of like a hidden area in your app, and then you can pull it back out by using that context and saying, okay, I need to pull that data in. And that is a reasonable way to go as well, but there are some downsides to that as well. For example, performance can be a problem because it will re-render everything along the way. If you make a change, if I replace the player array, it's going to re-render pretty much the whole tree from that parent component, which can be very problematic for performance reasons.
Yeah.